We're going to continue on in our discussion. We'll be talking about what I've called the war years, but it also includes the years leading up to the war. And there is a handout that Diana and DI are passing around. It's a one piece of paper, two-sided. So I hope everyone got it. We'll be talking about this period of time, which of course is a very dramatic one. It's a very heartbreaking period of time for many people. And there are a number of people in this room today who experienced the terrible tragedy of being taken away from their homes, being given only a very small window of time in which to gather all their possessions, and then to be carted off to assembly centers and relocation camps for the duration of the war. And so, since I was not one of them, I'd be very interested to hear from anyone who did take part in the events of World War II. I'd really enjoy, and I think everyone would appreciate, hearing about your experiences and learning from your insights as well. So, if you, you know, would like to, we'd certainly invite you to speak up and to join us in today's Dharma discussion. So anyway, the topic is the war years. But we talked a little bit last time about some of the situation in American society leading up to the war, the anti-Asian, in particular the anti-Japanese hysteria that arose specifically and was driven by some of the nativist groups in the West Coast, as well as people who wish to sort of regain control of farmlands that have been basically cultivated by Japanese immigrants, as well as people who were worried about the influx of cheap Asian labor. And this brought about an ongoing series of events, both real in nature. People were attacked, and many people lived under a real serious cloud of criticism and scrutiny and fear, but also on a sort of political and legal sphere, there were a lot of things happening. We talked about a lot of that last time. Just to kind of tie that discussion up, we discussed how there were a number of different laws that were passed in California. There were the alien land laws of 1913 and 1920. Which were passed in order to prevent Japanese immigrants from gaining control of farmlands and to discourage further Japanese immigration. In 1922, there was a U.S. Supreme Court decision that ruled that Japanese immigrants were ineligible to become naturalized U.S. citizens. And in 1924, there was the Oriental Exclusion Act, which was adopted in order to exclude from entry all aliens who would be ineligible for citizenship. So this would include Japanese and Chinese and people from other Asian countries as well. During this time, the FBI was very active in compiling a custodial detention index on citizens, enemy aliens, and foreign nationals in the name of national security. And in addition, there was the passage of the Alien Registration Act, which resulted in nearly 5 million persons of foreign ancestry being registered in the United States. Anyway, so a lot of this was going on at the time here in Berkeley. The temple was growing. The Nisei youth were becoming, they were growing up, becoming more active in a variety of ways. There were lots of activities, both religious and social in nature. And one of the activities that came up in temple discussions was the question of whether there should be a Japanese language school here at the Berkeley Buddhist Temple. Japanese language schools were kind of a source of some controversy throughout Japanese communities at the time, because the language schools were primarily geared for the Nisei youth. Again, born in the United States, and ostensibly to make sure that they maintain their mother tongue. But at the same time, Japanese language schools were quite clearly intended to cultivate within the young Nisei youth a spirit of Japanese sort of culture and Japanese identity. And so they became the object of a great amount of scrutiny by the anti-Japanese movement groups. And within each community, they also became the source of a certain amount of controversy. Here in Berkeley, it was certainly the case. In 1925, there was a big discussion taking place among the board of directors here at the Berkeley Buddhist Temple as to whether or not the temple should have a temple-sponsored Japanese language school, which the resident minister would be the superintendent. There was heated discussion, heated debate on both sides of the issue, and it was finally decided that a Japanese language school would be established. Those people, many of the people who were opposed to the idea, ended up leaving the temple, and they formed their own temple, which we know today as the Berkeley Higashi Honganji Temple. There's a lot more to the story, I think, than I mentioned here, and unfortunately, it's one of those stories that most of us really, we don't know what really, really happened. And unfortunately, it may be with the passing of time and with the passing away of people who were directly involved in the discussion, we may never know all of the insides, inside discussion of that time. But it was just one indication that here in Berkeley, certainly all of the things going around in society were having an impact in our Berkeley Buddhist Temple Sangha. Well, then we know that on December 7th, 1941, the Japanese military forces attacked the U.S. Naval Fleet at Pearl Harbor. This took not only the military but the country by surprise, and there was an immediate and a dramatic impact on the Japanese communities in the U.S. According to Kashima, almost immediately, he says, there followed a roundup of Issei community leaders, businessmen, teachers of Japanese martial arts, leaders of the Japanese Association, and Shinto and Buddhist priests. Almost all of the Buddhist priests at the time were Issei. They were Japanese immigrants. And because of the fact that they were, one, Buddhists, two, Japanese, and often Japanese language school instructors, they were highly suspect. And so they were rounded up almost immediately. And with this happening, you can imagine that for many of the members of the Bukkyokai, the Buddhist temples in the United States, this brought a tremendous amount of anxiety and fear, because their leaders were now gone, not just the ministers, but the lay leaders were also, many were also rounded up and incarcerated. And many people were afraid that they would also be the subject of attack because of their nationality and because of their religious beliefs. And so there are many, many stories that I've heard personally, and we've also heard generally about people discarding anything in their home that would be identified with Buddhism. People took their seiten, their service books, and they burned them. Some families, even if they couldn't destroy their obutsudan, their family altar, they hid it away. Some Buddhist artifacts or relics were buried in underground. And people were generally afraid. And I was out in Stockton, and I heard many, many stories of people who took their obutsudans and everything, anything associated with Japan, they threw it into the canal. And so this is not, that was not an uncommon thing. People were obviously living in fear. The time, again, the leadership then of the North American Buddhist Mission, the Hokube Bukkyodan, all leadership had been essentially taken away, except for one person. His name was Reverend Kenyo Kumata. He was a Nisei minister, and he sort of became the de facto leader of the Jodo Shinshu temples in America. He made frequent appeals to the FBI, to the naval authorities, trying to assert and to demonstrate the loyalty of Japanese Americans and Japanese American Buddhists. Many of his appeals, however, fell on deaf ears. A number of other things occurred. As many of you know, some of the people in charge of the question of later the administration of the internment program, people like Lieutenant General John L. DeWitt, Major Carl Bennett, Benditson, and others, they had a variety of agenda at work. DeWitt, of course, is famous for his anti-Japanese prejudice. He is reputed to have said, well, when it comes down to it, it doesn't matter if a person was born in Japan or born in America. It's his famous phrase, a Jap's a Jap. Then on February 19th, 1942, President Roosevelt issued or signed the Executive Order 9066, which authorized the military authorities to exclude anyone from prescribed military areas. And it allowed the military to decide what those vital and important military areas were. And so one of the major ones, the military area number one, was basically the entire West Coast. And it was determined that persons, enemy aliens, and those people who would be subject or suspected of perhaps allegiance with the enemy would be excludable.